lights. Like a TV studio, if you ever been to, and some of you have been to, you know. You walk into a TV studio, there are these bright lights, almost like this. This is the small lights, but you know, there are, you know, thousands and thousands of wattage, straight, like bright lights staring at you. Or you preach in some of these mega churches, or like, you know, where there's a lot of lighting and all that. If you go, if you confront an abundance of light, the first thing you experience is darkness. You know that? Because we call it a blinding light, right? Blinding. The light can blind you. That's irony, right? Darkness often comes from the lack of light. But interestingly enough, the darkness also can come from abundance of light. In other words, there is a bad kind of darkness, and there is also a good kind of darkness. Darkness that comes from light. Light, that's the way it happens. And Elijah, at this stage in his life, is experiencing the good kind of darkness. God has driven him into the wilderness, then into a cave where he is alone. He is buried from the planet Earth. Nobody knows where he is. He has completely disappeared. And there is fire going outside, there is wind outside, there is earthquake outside, there are a lot of spectacular things happening outside, but Elijah is buried. He is not getting to be part of all these exciting things that is happening outside, because he is in the cave, he is in darkness. Now, I'm sure Elijah's story you know, because he is probably one of the most, if not the most, powerful prophets in the Old Testament and even New Testament, even though Jesus said, you know, John the Baptist, but John the Baptist was like Elijah, they say, right? Like, you know, anyway. But Elijah's ministry actually starts from chapter 17 of 1 Kings. And he comes. We don't know where he is coming from. We only know Elijah the Tishbite, whatever that means. He just appears in front of the king Ahab, and he says, unless and until I speak, there is no going to be a dew or rain in the country. Well, that's a powerful, powerful prophecy, standing in front of the king and say. And he also says that he doesn't say, thus saith the Lord. It's very interesting. The first time, you know, you can go home and read, when Elijah appears in front of the king, normally the prophet says, thus saith the Lord, unless there is a word from the Lord. He doesn't even use the word Lord. He says, unless I say the word. He says, I. There is, the Lord is not in his vocabulary, right? And he has that boldness and the audacity to stand in front of the king, and he says, unless I speak a word, this nature is going to be controlled and it's going to be confined into a drought, right? And the next thing we see Elijah is that he withdraws, or God asks him to withdraw into a Kerit, like, you know, the brook of Kerit, where he is basically hanging out with a bunch of ravens. There is nobody there. No friends, no relatives, no disciples, no church. All he has is a bunch of ravens. They will bring him food and he will eat it, and then, you know, you know the story, Elijah's story. Then he happens to meet a widow who is like a very poor widow, not like the one Elisha met, you know, later. And this woman was going to die, but then he had to eat from whatever little left of her. And you know the story, and you know, he had this, disciples, the widow and the widow's son, and the death and resurrection. But it is all very, very private moments, right? It's a private ministry. He doesn't have any recognition at all as a minister or as a prophet. Now then, finally, in chapter 18 comes the biggest moment. I mean, I would say, without any question, one of the most spectacular showdown in the entire Bible. Right? Mount Carmel. And Elijah invites, or rather challenges, right, the 450 prophets of Baal to come to this the mountain, and invites the king and the everybody, the whole town has gathered, the whole city has gathered in Mount Carmel. Then Elijah on one side, 450 prophets of Baal on the other side, and you know what happened, right? And they were crying, you know, they had two oxen, and you know, one ox with Baal, and they couldn't get the thing going. And then Elijah does offer his sacrifice, and he even dig a trench around it and fill it with water, and the fire comes from the Lord and consumes what is in the altar and also licks up the water from the trench. Now that is, it's really like, you know, you get an opportunity to preach at, I don't know, Super Bowl halftime show, Super Bowl halftime, they always invite the celebrities. The whole nation watch that thing. You know, if I get to preach at, you know, at the Super Bowl, that's almost like that, or, you know, much more than that, actually. You know, or if I get to do a miracle, you know, or I get to change the fate of the nation, that's exactly what is happening. And then he comes, 450 prophets, and everything is all right. And then maybe he thought, this is my moment. Finally, after hanging out with a bunch of ravens and, you know, with a widow and her son and all this kind of stuff, finally, I got my moment. I am in the limelight. The entire nation, like Darkas, they all saw what I did. And the nation is about to change. I am in the epicenter of the change God is bringing about. But the next thing you see is this prophet is going into wilderness. And then wilderness in itself is bad. 40 days and 40 nights, he walks through the wilderness to Mount Horeb and ends up in a cave and stuck there. You know, there's a saying, strike when the iron is hot, right? If I am God, thankfully I'm not, this is the time I want to use my prophet. Everything is, this is when the iron is hot. This is when I want Elijah to start his ministry. This is when I want him to register his ministry. This is when I want him to go to Twitter, and he will have millions of followers because they are all watching it. This is the time. This is it. This is now. And the chapter 18 ends by saying that Prophet Elijah outran the chariots of Ahab. Like, this guy has become literally Superman. Literally, you know, not even figuratively. You fly across a chariot. And this is it. This is the time. I don't get it. Chapter 19 is a complete mismatch. It's a baffling mystery for this prophet to be driven out into a complete opposite of where he is. Now, the prophets find himself in a cave, stuck in a cave. Right after that bright light comes the darkness, the blinding light, the spectacular vision, the spectacular episode in his chapter comes with this blindness. He can't see anything, stuck in a cave. Now there, the prophet is basically wrestling with voices in his head. You know how difficult it is to be a prophet? I'm not boasting, but every preacher of the New Testament is a prophet. If you are not a prophet, you should never preach. You think you can read some commentaries and come up with a sermon, and that's what I used to think? Never, ever do that. Unless and until you hear from the Lord, never open a word in a public setting in a church. Now that is exactly what the prophets used to do. That is what a prophet is supposed to do. Not telling your future. You know all that, and I'm not going to get into that. But as a very, 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 very junior prophet, I go through this struggle all the time. There are voices in my head. It's almost like being schizophrenic. And you have to identify and discern what exactly is the Lord speaking. And I'm not kidding you. Like, you know, when Vasanandra told us just 10 minutes ago that when you meditate on the powerful name of God, think about about something you cannot fight on your own, right? Use the power. You know what I thought about? I was thinking about my own voice. There are so many other things I wanted, but this is to me the most. Now I'll explain what happened. Okay, let me go to Elijah. Then you probably think, what is there something wrong with Vashti? Okay, Elijah was confronted mainly by three voices in his head. One is the voice of Jezebel, you know, the queen. Immediately after the showdown, Jezebel said, "I am going to kill this prophet. He killed all my prophets, all the prophets who are eating my table. He's not going to live as long as I am the queen." Now, that is one voice, the voice of the evil, the voice of the devil, right? Then there is a second voice, that is voice of Elijah himself. Now, that is even more difficult to wrestle. Elijah, you know, the scripture says he was afraid of death and ran away. But really, when you read it, he's not afraid of death at all. He has God, kill me. That's what he's saying. I am done. I don't want this ministry. I did not sign up for this. I don't want you to call me. I didn't ask you to call me. Done. You know, I'm done. I want to die. That's exactly what Elijah says. You can go home and read it, and I'm pretty sure you know the story, right? So Elijah is not afraid of death. If that is the case, then he would have asked the Lord, "Save me, save my life." No, that's it. He said, "I don't mind dying, but I don't want to die by the hands of Jezebel. Because dying by the hand of your enemy is worse than death. It is humiliation. If there is something worse than death itself, it is humiliation. Death of our ego, our self. Believe me, that's much more painful than real death. I've never done real death. None of us have been in real death. But I'm telling you, the death of our ego, death of humiliation, the fear of public humiliation, the fear of being isolated and secluded and becoming a nobody and ignored and neglected, and that is much more painful than physical death. And Elijah was ready to die physical death, and he wanted to die, but God wouldn't let him die. And he says, "I'm not better than any of my ancestors. Don't think that I'm the most powerful prophet in the Bible. I am not. I want to die." Now that's the second voice. And then the third voice is the voice of God. God is telling Elijah, "Elijah, you are nowhere near that. And I want you to receive power and use that power for the ministry. Your ministry is only going to unfold," right? Now, what is happening in that cave is a real mystery. I don't really know what is happening in the cave. But it is very mystic in the sense that I think Elijah is trying to learn to discern the voice of God there. Because even though he started in a very powerful way, it is a little egoistic way. Like I said, you know, go home and read 1 Kings chapter 17, where Elijah the Tishbite goes to the king and says, "Unless my word," I'm sure he got it from the Lord, but he said, he was all about me, my, I. That's the way he starts. It's okay, because he heard from the Lord, it happened anyway. But here, God is like tuning his. Okay, let me put it this way. And we all talk about this still small voice Elijah heard, right? Still small voice. I mean, it's very popular. There are so many songs and so many sermons. Let me ask you, how many of you have heard a still small voice in your head? I'm pretty sure all of you. If not, yeah, thank you. I pray. If you haven't heard that, there is something wrong with you. Because every human being hears still small voice in their head all the time. Even now, you know, there is something going on. What is wrong with Pastor Matthew today? This is not the real sermon. When is he going to stop? There is mission center. There must be some dinner out there. That good smell. Maybe, you know, maybe it's just my thoughts. Or, you know, maybe I'm hearing Atkinson's thought. Or, we have this thought that there's still small voice speaking to all of us. That is part of humanity. And the Bible goes deeper in to say that voice has the voice of God in itself. Or it says, okay, let me read from Romans chapter 2:15 talks about this still small voice speaking to us, right? This is what Paul says. In that they show the work of the law written in their heart, their conscience bearing witness, and their thoughts alternately accusing or else defending them on the day when, according to my gospel, God will judge the secrets of men through Christ. Anyway, what Paul is essentially saying is that God's law is written in our heart. It is ingrained in our very, very being. We came programmed automatically. Factory loaded software is already in us. So that is kind of, that is our conscience, the voice of God, the voice of the manufacturer, the software of the algorithm of the manufacturer is coded in us so that we will automatically think what the Lord is speaking to us. You don't really need a prophet. You don't really need a lot of books to read. But the voice of conscience, if that can be purified, it is like the law written in your heart. That's the voice of conscience. If you do something bad, you automatically feel guilty conscience. Right? Remember? Guilty conscience. Or if you do something good, then you say, okay, I have clear conscience in this, right? I'm clear conscience, which means that I'm not feeling bad, because this is the law written. This is the voice of God speaking. This is the still small voice speaking, not just to Elijah, not just to all of you, all of us, all of humanity. This still small voice is speaking. But there is a problem, right? The problem is, there are two problems. One, this voice of conscience, because we are fallen human beings, you know, what happened in Genesis chapter 3. Because we are fallen human beings, the voice of conscience right now is sort of culturally conditioned. That's a, you know, polite way of saying it. But if I take an extreme example, these jihadists, the extreme fundamentalist Muslims who are killing people over in the Middle East, the ISIS and the Al-Qaeda, you know, they have clear conscience. They don't feel anything bad at all because they are following the voice of their conscience. And their conscience is culturally conditioned, which we will say corrupted. So that is the problem with our conscience. Even though we all hear the still small voice of the Spirit, if we are all going to follow our conscience, this church will be, you know, 100 people doing 100 different things. So we cannot trust the voice of conscience because of what happened to us, right? And the second problem with the voice of conscience is, if we disobey that first instinct, the voice, the still small voice, when it speaks to you, the problem is that it can be bypassed. If fire speaks to you, if the wind speaks to you, you cannot, like, you know, the wind blowing on your face, there's nothing you can basically do. You just obey, right? Or fire, God speaks through your fire, there is no, I'm not going to do it now. Let me do it tomorrow. It's fire, it's going to consume you. It's wind, it's going to blow you off. You know, it's so spectacular, it's right in your face. But still small voice, the problem with the still small voice is, we can always say no. Or we can always say, maybe later. Or maybe let me think about it. Or we can dialogue with it, or even debate with it. And because of what happens because of that is, you know, it's like, you know, very, very often I have the analogy of the car seat signal in your car. You know, one of the things about car seat signal, if you don't put the car seat, you know, what will happen? It will give you this annoying beeping sound, right? But then you drive, I don't know, 100 meters or something, what happens? It stops. I wish the car stopped. I wish they created the signal in such a way that if you don't put the car signal, the car will stop, you cannot drive. That makes a little more sense. But for various reasons, and I'm sure they have done enough research to why it will only give you a warning. And if you don't obey it, the signal will just stop. It will not talk to you anymore. Now that is the problem with the still small voice of conscience. If you override that voice of conscience, it becomes stagnant, it becomes silent, it becomes muted. And that's how we have people like we call sociopaths and psychopaths. You must have heard some of this terminology. They don't feel anything. They can kill a number of people and they just feel they are just as cool as a cucumber or like anybody. They don't feel guilt because they don't get that signal for whatever reason. There could be psychological. But I know there are spiritual paths. I have meant spiritual paths. It's not even a word. There are people whose ability to connect with God almost permanently impaired. It doesn't matter what you say to them. It doesn't matter however you try to expound the Bible and, you know, try to tell them this is the truth, and they are confronted with it. And God is speaking to them too through various means, but they don't get it. They don't get it. They can't connect with God. The point I'm trying to make is the still small voice of conscience is being in constant dialogue with the voice of the Jezebel on one side and voice of God on the other side. So these three voices in your head, that's why I said, you know, I pray that, Lord, if I can suppress my voice, the voice that comes from ego, the danger is that you will never, it's very difficult to discern between your voice and God's voice. I don't worry about voice of Jezebel. Not that I don't worry about it, but I can very clearly distinguish. We know when the devil speaks, right? It's much easier to recognize when the Jezebel speaks. But when our own conscience manipulates us, it is very, very, very difficult. We often think it is from God, and we end up doing a lot of blunder in the process. We'll get hurt, and we'll also hurt other people. I've done that. That's why I know. Right? So I always pray that if I can suppress that voice of my own voice in the whole process. In other words, can you purify my conscience so that the still small voice I hear in this cave will always be from the Holy Spirit?
Amen.
Now that is the process I believe is happening in the cave. It's a very sacred process. Very, very painful process. And God is purifying the conscience of Elijah so that every word that comes out of his mouth, every voice he hears in the back of his mind is the voice of God. Because that only then he can be on constant communion with God. The problem with us is, you know, how many times people come to me and ask, you know, Pastor Matthew, we are going through this because we want to know what the Lord is speaking to us on this issue, which is okay. You know, I've done that too. Sometimes I do even now too. But the problem, the best way for God to speak to you is that be always in communication with you so that you don't have to go for the fire and the wind. But if you can, if you allow God to purify your conscience or calibrate, you know, maybe I'm losing you here, but you know, okay, let me give you an example. I remember, you know, as Pastor Philip was leading worship, and this is like one of my dreams. I'm very bad at music, but when I was in college, and I wanted to be a guitarist. And my dad, I still remember, he gave me a tuition to, you know, I actually lied to him, actually. I said, I want to go for tuition. I never gone for tuition for one of my subjects. So my engineering fellow, I said, electronic circuits and design, there's a paper, it's very tough. My dad, you know, he hasn't even gone to college, so he didn't understand. He said, okay, he gave me 400 rupees or something, which was big money back in the days, to tuition. But actually, I didn't want to go to tuition. I bought a guitar with that, $350 for guitar, 350 rupees for guitar. Back in the days, it's, I don't know, more 30 years or so. And then I went to for this guitar class for the first time. My master actually is very famous even in Kerala even now. And I went in the first class. Man, like he was teaching us how to tune guitar. And the whole 1 hour, you know, there are different guitars. And, you know, first of all, you know, they teach. So basically, and if there are people who don't know much about music and the instruments, all the guitars or even the piano and all the other instruments have to be tuned to the same voice, right? There are basically seven, I think, letters like A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and then again they start from A, B, C, D. So the first class, all this teacher was doing is there are a bunch of five guitars, and then he started, okay, this is then we all have to say, but we all don't really resonate with the same sound, then we have to twist and turn that little thing, and it hurts your hands too. And then then I get A, right? Then the other guy doesn't get A. He's still in B or C or whatever, right? So the whole day is because it's such a repetitious and such a boring process. And I thought the first week and I'm going to be a rock and roll star. And that's what I wanted, right? I mean, you know, if I was a Christian, I was not a Christian at the time, but I was a Christian, I wanted to be Hillsongs. You know, I don't want to be a preacher. Who wants to be a preacher when you can play guitar, right? These are the dreams you're going to the class, and all they're doing that E, D, D, B, B. I'm like, really, first of all, they're only so if there is T and M and all that, at least you can hear 26, right? Like, it's not that boring. You can hear. So all the seven letters, the whole 1 hour, it's all about E, E, D, D. And that was the last time I went to the, and I've never used that guitar. What I'm saying is, this is exactly what is happening in that cave. That Elijah is learning to tune to the frequency of the Holy Spirit, so that his conscience is so calibrated, so purified, that the music that comes from both this instrument, which is the Holy Spirit, and the conscience of Elijah, is going to be literally the same. It's funny, listen to me here, okay? This is literally true, this repetition process of B, B, E, E. So, when we read chapter 19, I started from verse 11, but if you read 9 and 10, okay, follow me here. Chapter 19, verses 9 and 10, I'm going to read this, listen to this. Then he came there to a cave and lodged there, and behold, the word of the Lord came to him. And he said to him, listen to this, what exactly is written in that verses, okay? He said to him, that the Lord is speaking to him, what are you doing here, Elijah? He said, I've been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the sons of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with sword, and I alone am left, and they seek my life to take it away. Okay? What I read is verses 9 and 10 of chapter. Okay? I'm going to read verses 13 and 14. Not 9 and 10, verse 13 and 14. This is what's happening. And behold, a voice came to him. This is the still small voice he's hearing. This is after the cave incident. After the cave, the still small voice that came to him is asking, what are you doing here, Elijah? Then he said, I've been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the sons of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword, and I alone am left, and they seek my life to take it away. Have you heard this somewhere else? Yeah, just before. Verses 9 and 10, just before the cave, this incident already happened. It's happening again after the cave from the still small voice. B, B, C, C, D, D. The voice of the Lord which came to you, and the Holy Spirit is making sure it is exactly now you are hearing with the still small voice in your head. After the cave, that is exactly the calibration process. That is the tuning process where your conscience is so purified that what you're hearing, the still small voice you're hearing, is actually the voice of God. The problem with us, you know, we want to tune our conscience to the fire and to the wind and to the earthquake. That's what we are taught to do, you know, we want spectacular, because we always associate God with magnificent thing. But God says, no, I'm going to teach you in this cave to tune so that you will always, always listen to my voice. See, the Bible can be taken away from you. The church will be taken away from you one day, the day of persecution. I was watching a documentary of Russian persecution, tortured for Christ. You probably know Richard Bunker and all that. One of the things that I was fascinated while this guy, you know, reenacting some of his prison experience, he says, when he was deep down in the basement of a Russian prison, he said, I've never felt so close to God and so happy, like anytime else. It still doesn't make sense to me. Because then he says this, they could take away our Bible, they could take away our family, they could take away our church, but they couldn't take away my conscience, because the still small voice is not something somebody else can switch off. Because that is something which will always come with you.
Amen.
And that is why God is very, very, very particular that we have to tune to the frequency of God. We have to calibrate our conscience so that we will always listen from God. You know, Mount Horeb, actually by name, there are only two main places it is mentioned. You remember Mount Horeb, that's where it's happening, in a cave in Mount Horeb. Where do you hear that before? Moses, right? Moses went to Mount Horeb. 40 days and 40 nights. Remember, there is a lot of things. Again, B, B, C, C. Repeating, Mount Horeb. Moses, 40 days and 40 nights. God wrote his commandments on a tablet. And here, for Elijah, God is writing his commandment in his conscience. Right? Isn't that the promise of the New Testament? In the New Testament, you know, we say Paul said in 2 Corinthians 3:3, he said, you are a letter of Christ written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of human heart. That is actually a promise of New Testament. Elijah is living in it in a symbolic way. That in Mount Horeb, the process is being repeated. For Moses, God spoke to him through the tablets of stone, but for Elijah, he is writing his commandments, his law in his conscience, so that he doesn't have to look for the Bible. He doesn't have to scribble through a tablet, but it is already so programmed within it, within him, so that he will have that. Or, you know, when we say, have the mind of Christ, you know, sometimes we just say things so easily. Can you even imagine what we just said? Have the mind of Christ? How dare we say even that, right? Do you even know our mind? Some of the thoughts that go through our mind, and sometimes we wonder, where is it coming from? Do we know our spouse's mind? Do we know our friend's mind? But we claim or we pray that we want the mind of Christ. We should, because that's what's in the Bible, right? We have to have the mind of Christ. But remember, when you pray that, you are praying a very, very dangerous prayer. Because God might take you seriously. If God takes you seriously, you are in trouble. You are going to be dragged out of Mount Carmel and into the wilderness and to the cave. And there will be stuck in the cave in the darkness. When everything else is happening around, you are stuck in the cave because God is going to calibrate your conscience. So be careful before you pray that prayer. He might just give you the mind of Christ. Might be a tough process to go through. You know, I still remember when I was in my seminary, you know, first time when I entered seminary, and, you know, I was not very good at writing essays. Because I was an engineering student, I only do equations and all that. So the first time for the long time, I had to write an essay. And my professor, particularly the professor of church history, I remember, so he wouldn't grade my paper. So all this, you know, everybody said, they said, Matthew, come and speak to me in my office, right? When your professor says that, you know you are in trouble, right? And some of the teachers are here. Matthew, come and speak to me in my office. I'm like, okay. So then, you know, I'm not going to give you the detail, but he would mentor me. He understood, you know, why I can't write essays, because I didn't know whatever the thesis is, how you create the argument and all that. That's not the way I was trained, and he understood. And he would mentor me, and I got an A+ in his class in the end. But the fact is, you know, Jesus did the same thing too, right? Mark chapter 4 or so, where it says, you know, Jesus talked to people in parable. Many people think that Jesus talked in parables so that people can understand. No. The Bible very clearly says that Jesus spoke in parable because people don't understand. Because only the elect will understand, only the people who are tuned to the frequency of God will understand. And then it says, he will take the disciples in private and explain the meaning. That's kind of what this professor did to me. He would take me in private and explain, because Jesus wanted his disciples to spend time with them so that they will be imparted the mind of Christ. And they will be stuck in the cave with Jesus. And there they will receive his mind, receive the meaning. In the same way my professor helped me, and I kind of got to know him. I kind of understood the mind of him in so many ways. Even now I think like him, and I try to mentor other people like him. So the point I'm trying to make is, sometimes God drags you into the cave, and you think, oh my, look at everybody else. They are there enjoying the Mount Carmel, the peak of Mount Carmel. They are speaking to God in fire. There is earthquake. There is wind. I am stuck in this cave. What in the world is wrong with me? I will tell you what is wrong with you, because you prayed, you wanted to have the mind of Christ, and he's going to give you the mind of Christ. For that, you have to be in trouble. You have to go through this process of private time with your master. In that silence, the deadly silence, the blind darkness, God speaks to you. But never be dismayed. That darkness is not because of the lack of light, but it is because of the overabundant presence of light.
Amen.
That is that darkness you feel. So God wants us to be that Christians who always see him, even in the mundane daily life, you know. Not in the spectacular Sundays, or when we hear a testimony, or when we have some miracle in our life. No, every single day of every single moment, he wants us to be same Christian, so that we won't be so excited and elated when some amazing things happen, and when something goes wrong, we'll be so bad and we'll be in so desperate. He wants us to have his constant presence and constant communion with him. That's why he is taking us into a cave and purifying our conscience, so that still small voice will be the voice of God. So that you don't need a prophet or even a pastor to hear from the Lord. The Lord will speak from inside. That's the beauty of Elijah's life. And that's what happened to the rest of his ministry. The prophet who went into the cave was not the same prophet who came out of it. You know, I don't want to be still in, I love Mount Carmel. I love that kind of experience. I love elation and all that. But I would rather be in a cave in Mount Horeb than in the peak of Mount Carmel. Both are important. But being in a cave, stuck in a cave with God is even more exciting. And I'm going to pray that dangerous prayer for all of you. And that's my prayer for ICA. Don't feel mad. You know, that's an exciting experience, so that we will all have the mind of Christ and we will know what the Lord is speaking to us, and so that we will exude that joy and the glory into the